Okay, no. When it comes to building social assemblages, absolutely anything goes. Any ideology or even religion will do, even the most archaic. All that matters is that it be used as the raw material of existence. The resingularizing assemblages of the post-media era cannot come into existence without pulling together available fragments from existing and even dissipated assemblages. Order can arise from chaos, but order cannot arise from the void.
通过刚才您讲的那个话，您的那个就所谓残留物和符号学的替代物，通过赋予残留物和符号学的替代物，以创造性和生产性的用途。其实残留物和这个就是这个符号学替代物，就是以前的就是旧的装配，这个残留，就是崩解的、崩解过的或者说那个正在崩解的。那么也即作为主体化心魔式的催化剂，而不是作为去权的节点，这个就是empowerment。不去权利，empowerment是赋权嘛，那么不是作为去权的节点，那么它通过将主体性成分这个节点，通过将主体性成分卷入其漩涡之中，充满了符号学的黑洞，这个黑洞和白黑白是也是德勒兹瓜塔项目经的用的一些表达，那么装配得以适应变化，通过这种方式装配可以变化，因此这不是一个现代化对老旧对古旧的问题。根据这个瓜塔利的生态ecosophy 的这个原则呢，当涉及到社会装配的这个创建之时，一切东西都完全可以参与社会装配的创建，包括任何的意识形态，甚或是宗教，也不论其是否老旧。重要的是这些东西可以被用作存在的原材料 raw materials。如果不将现存的甚至已经消解的装配的可再利用的碎片，重新整合起来。那么后媒体时代的所谓的重新特异化的进程性的装配就不能形成，那么秩序也就是存在可以从混沌中诞生，但是它不能从void 从空无中诞生。
So-called culture clashes symptomatize social assemblage problems. Islamic fundamentalism has been explained away as a culturalist backlash and anti-Western extremism. Similarly, the post-Soviet nationalist independence movements have been cast as a release of pent-up ethnic tensions that totalitarian communism had contained. This is not how Guattari viewed these situations. He reads the demands of these groups as collective refusals of the standardized capitalist subjectivities on offer. No matter how socially conservative their agendas, these groups resist capitalism's imposition of a system of valuation based on general equivalency and the standardized subjectivities that it produces as a result. Guattari suggests that respite from the flattening, homogenizing effects of capitalism's deterritorializations can be sought in three directions. Reterritorializations onto the residues of archaic assemblages, destructive annihilation, or the invention of mutant, singularizing processual assemblages which are more collective, more social, and more political. Guattari's portrait of integrated world capitalism, however, remains too monolithic, especially given today's many capitalisms. Industrial, financial, speculative, authoritarian, export-driven, consumerist, and so on. However, his question remains relevant. Will the 21st century become mired in reactionary reterritorializations, which form in counterpoint to the numerous deterritorializing assemblages that began emerging in the early Middle Ages? Or will interactive personal media facilitate the creation of singularizing processual assemblages?
Okay. 那现在要评论这个所谓的文化冲突论，那我们知道是亨廷顿这样的哈。那么他们所谓的文化冲突呢，那个是社会装配问题的症状。伊斯兰那个原教旨主义呢，经常被解释为一种文化主义的这个激烈的反应，和一种反西方的极端主义。 同样呢，后苏联时代的这个国族主义运动、国族独立运动呢，被描述为所谓极权主义的共产主义所以前遏制住的这个潜在族群矛盾的这个爆发、这个释放。那么这不是巴塔利看到这个问题的这个情形的方式。那么他将这些群体的诉求解读为，不是说是反共什么的哈，他解读为是反资本主义，解读为对可供的 on offer 的这种可供的标准化资本主义的这个主体性的集体拒绝，不管他们的这个目标是多么的保守，他们也是对资本主义的拒绝。这些群体抵抗着资本主义强加给他们一种基于这个普遍等价交换的价值体，就是资本主义的这资本逻辑吧。他们也拒绝这种价值体系生产出来的标准化的主体性，比如说这个个人主义的消费主体这样的。那么瓜塔利建议呢，可以从三个方向来寻求缓解资本主义解域化所产生的那个拉平的均质化的效果的方法。三种方法是什么？哪三种呢？第一，是对老旧装配的残留物进行再狭域化，或者第二种是破坏性的毁灭，第三种是或者是发明善变的特异化的进程性的装配，就 processional 这个 assemblage。那么这种装配呢，将更具有集体性、社会性和政治性。那考虑到今天的诸种资本主义、工业的、金融的、投机的，还有威权主义的、出口导向的，或者消费主义的资本主义等等，那么瓜塔利对一体化的世界资本主义的描述，显得有点过于单一。但是他的问题也是重要的，是切题的。他的问题是什么呢？二十一世纪将会陷入与中世纪早期开始出现的种种的解域的装配相对立的反动的再狭域化吗？或者互动性的个人媒体将有助于创建一种特异化的进程性的装配呢？
Claims of ethnic traditionalists may be understood as alternatives to secular modernist internationalism. So with the Kosovi, Guattari offers an alternative. Ecosophy offers strategies for constructing livable, particularized ethnic territories adapted to changing historical conditions. This is why Europeans have a lot to learn from the way immigrants reinvent and reconstitute their culture, according to Guattari. The fifth world, which is the world the name he gave for the ethnic traditionalists, the fifth world has much more to offer than its quaint cultural relics suitable for display. Schizoanalysis, which is what Guattari called his version of psychoanalysis, schizoanalysis learns from the schizophrenic, who pieces together a world from semiotic fragments. In treating psychosis, the schizoanalyst's aim is to, and I'm quoting Guattari here, increase as much as possible the range of means offered in the recomposition of a patient's corporeal, biological, psychical, and social territories. Likewise, a schizoanalytic approach to extreme global deterritorialization would entail expanding the range of components and materials of expression available for enriching and recomposing collective existential territories, whether these territories be corporeal, biological, psychical, or social. Immigrants are leading the way as schizoanalysts of globalization. Guattari places his sociopolitical hopes in the fifth world of immigrants and cultural traditionalists because, out of necessity and in order to survive, they are already inventing ways to renew cultural values and social practices for our epoch, wisely retaining what works from previous regimes, in addition to inventing completely new existential territories. Such territories need not be based on ethnicity, culture, or even place.
那么作为世俗的现代主义的这个国际主义，这个国际主义它主要是讲资产阶级的国际主义啊。这作为世俗的现代主义的国际主义的替代性的选择呢，生态智慧可以建设 建设为建设可居住的特殊化的适应于各种正在变化的历史条件的存在之余提供了方略。这就是为什么欧洲人就是可以从移民这个身上呢重新可以从移民重新发明和重建其文化的这种方式中学到很多东西。这巴塔利的说法比起适合于展示的这个古拜的这个一些文化的遗物呢，第五世界有更多的东西可以提供。就是这个第五世界他刚才说是这是巴塔利的提出一个概念。他一般来讲第三世有三个世界，那他有第四世界有第五世界。那么第五世界呢他有一个典型的代表性的人权，就是这个移民和边缘人权。那么这是他的这个巴塔利的一个有名的这个概念，或一本书一个文章里面，就是作为民族主义的这个第五世界民族主义的第五世啊、民叫民族主义的第五世界吧，好像这个书这个文章民族主义的第五世界这个用的词跟那个 nationalist 不一样的一个词，他自造的一个词。那么他可以从第五世界中第五世界有更多的东西可以提供给欧洲人，给现代人。那么瓜塔利的精神分离分析呢，他刚才说这个是这个瓜塔利的这个啊，不是，对不起，瓜塔利的精神分裂分析是瓜塔利的这个精神分析的版本，就是跟以前的这个拉康啊，跟那个弗洛伊德不一样的一个精神分析的版本吧。那么瓜塔利的精神分裂分析呢，可以像根据符号学碎片将世界串联起来的精神分裂症患者学习。那么这个精神分裂症患者在德勒兹瓜塔利来讲，它不是一个贬义词，它有可能是挑战资本主义的一个重要的主题。那么在治疗精神病的时候呢，精神分裂症分析师的这个目标是尽可能的增加可供的手段来重组病人物质的生物的精神的和社会的界域。同样呢，应对全球极度解离化的一种精神分裂症的分析路径呢，要求扩展可利用成分的范围和表达的材料，来丰富和重组集体性的存在之欲，不管这种存在之欲呢是物质的、生物的、精神的还是社会的。作为全球化之精神分裂症分析师的移民们正在引领着这个道路。瓜塔利将其社会政治的希望放置于这个第五世界呢，是因为出于必要和旨在生存，第五世界的人们已经发明了更新我们时代的文化价值和社会实践的方法。他们明智地实存着以往体制所遗留下的起作用的东西，就刚才说这个 work 那些东西，同时发明了全新的存在性的界域、存在之域。那么此种界域呢，不需要以种族、文化甚至处所为基础。
Cultural element can detach itself and serve as an existential operator. Existential operators create by assembling, bringing together various components and assemblages, transforming them and keeping them going. Existential operators act as the umbilical points of new worlds.
这又用了一个新的这个概念，就是说存在性的这个算子，这个是一个这个数学用语 ，operators 存在性的算子，算这个算子就是一种好像一种函数吧，说是一种函数，这是这个一个算子就是一个把这种把实质或者赋值的函数转化为其他。赋值或者是实质函数的这个规则。那么人类的社会行构呢，同样也依赖于这种存在性的算子。比如这个刚才讲的那个迭戈啊，他也可以算是一种算子。那么存在性的算子呢，通过组装 assembling 来创造，将不同的这个组分，刚才讲的这个组成成分，就是有科学术语叫组分。将不同的组分和装配联系在一起，并转换它们，促使它们发动。那么存在性的算子呢，起到了新世界之起点的作用。 脐带点，因为这个母体这个跟我们婴儿联系这个脐带点是非常重要的一个起源点。
I think that an example of an existential operator is the Islamic head covering. And I don't know if it was in the news here, but in Europe especially, the Islamic head covering is very controversial. France will not allow girls to attend school if they're wearing the head covering, and there are a couple of other countries that also have restrictions on it. I think it's a mistake to see the Islamic head covering as a mere signifier, however. It's a semiotic operator because it functions on the level of affect and intensity to organize and to disrupt subjectivities as well as social relations. The head covering is semiotic, but it is not discursive. It is both a refrain as a ritual object, as well as a form of faciality. Refrain and faciality are ideas from A Thousand Plateaus. And what faciality does is demarcate those who belong from those who do not belong. As such, the head covering is a semiotic component of passage, meaning that it can disengage itself from an assemblage, bifurcate in many directions, whether toward oppressive reterritorialization, a subjective black hole where it would annihilate itself, or a singularizing line of flight where it would take off and create a new assemblage. Although many argue that the veil cannot possibly contribute to any liberation project, it has certainly undergone a series of deterritorializations. Originally, a clothing of desert peoples whose attachment to a hot part of the earth necessitated protection from the sun, the head covering was deterritorialized by Islam, which detached it from the earth in order to make it a ritual garment required by a disembodied monotheistic god. Many Westerners interpret the head covering as a simple index of women's oppression. European neo-nationalists take the head covering to be a territorial refrain, like a bird song or brightly colored tail feathers, deploying in a re-territorializing attempt to Islamize Europe. There's a lot of anxiety in Europe that Islam will take over, re-territorialize it.
那么这个刚才讲的这个 operator 算子，那么他觉得这个有一个这个比较那个比较切合的例子，就是这个伊斯兰那个妇女所戴的头巾，它是可以这个算作一个这个算子的例子。那么伊斯兰头巾呢，他认为提供了一个很好的这个残留性的文化物品的例子。不管是好是坏吧，它起到一个这个存在性的算子的作用。那么伊斯兰头巾，它大家都知道，它那刚才简单解释说，这个在欧洲争议很大。这个就是很多人不赞成，就在学校有禁令，不能那个戴头巾上学，如果戴头巾上学可能被开除。那么将伊斯兰头巾仅仅视为一种能指，它会是一种错误，它是一个符号学的算子，因为它作用于这个感 effect， 作用于感受和强度性的层面，intensity， 这都是他们的专门术语，它作用于感受和强度性的层面，从而来组织和扰乱主体性和社会关系。那么头巾是符号性的，但不是话语性的。它同时是一种迭歌，刚才讲的那个 reference， 如同这种仪式性的物品，或者是一种它同时是一种迭歌和一种这个 faciality， 就是 faciality 是面目性。那么那个千万里面翻了颜貌，那么这个刚才他解释说，这个所谓的面目性或者颜貌呢，它就是一种划分那个谁属于或者谁不属于某个群体的一种东西吧。那么就此而论呢，它是一种过程过程性的这个符号性组分，一个 passage， 那么意味着它能够使自己与一种装配相脱离，向各个方向来分叉，不管是向着压迫性的再狭义化，还是向着一个主体性的黑洞，这也是他们的专门的这个一些说法，还是向着一个特异化的逃逸线，这种可能特异化的逃逸线可能是一种解放性的。尽管许多人论辩说， 面纱不太可能有助于任何的解放方案，但是面纱本身无疑经历了一系列的解域化的过程。本来沙漠居民因其生活在地球上很热的地区，使得能够抵挡炎热的太阳的这个装束呢成为必要。作为此种装束的头巾呢，从这个意义上来讲是被伊斯兰教解域化的。伊斯兰教因为伊斯兰教使头巾从抵御大地的炎热，这一实际作用超脱出来，将其变成一种disembodied 的这种不具形体的这种单一神，就是那个正安拉，单一神所要求的仪式性的装束，它已经这个解域化了。那么许多西方人将头巾解释为妇女压迫的这个纯粹标志，那么欧洲的新国族主义者呢，将其视为一种戒欲性的迭歌，就像鸟的歌唱，或者是它亮丽的舒展的尾羽那样，是一种迭歌。那么这些人认为呢，这个头巾被伊斯兰教这个有效的利用，企图重新进行狭域化，来伊斯兰化欧洲。
In secular countries like France and Turkey, both of which have restricted the head coverings, some women wear the head covering in defiance, demanding emancipation from official restrictions on public dress. For some women who wear the head covering, it serves as a nucleus of subjectivation, constituting a portable existential territory that shelters the wearer from the penetrating gaze of strangers.
在一些这个坚定的世俗化的国家，像法国、像土耳其这样的国家呢，那么有些妇女她对这种的这个限制比较反感，她抗命，就反倒她戴上这些头巾。那么他们这个举措呢，是一种姿态吧，是要求从这种官方的禁令中，有关公共穿戴的这个限制中解放出来。那对一些戴头巾的这个妇女来讲呢，头巾作为一种主体化的核心，构建了一种可移动的存在性、存在之域，那么使得穿戴者能够避免陌生人目光的穿刺。
In her book, Questioning the Veil,Sociologist Marnia Lazreg insists that the Islamic head covering could never bifurcate toward a liberating, deterritorializing line of flight. She provides an overview of the re-veiling trend based on interviews with women all over the world, in Muslim countries as well as in Europe and North America. While she argues that states and their institutions should neither require nor ban head coverings,She urges women not to veil. She reasons that the veil is not required by the Quran, at least according to a certain reading. The veil is cumbersome. Its wearing is mandated by men for their benefit, and so forth. She gives a number of reasons not to veil. Noting that the revival of the veil is an organized campaign promoted by Islamic leaders, she rejects the idea that women may freely choose the veil,Because, she argues, the veil is inextricably associated with patriarchal power structures.
那么这个有一个社会学家叫这个马尼亚这个拉斯雷格这一个女社会学家，她写了一本书叫质疑面纱一本书。他在这个书中坚持认为呢，伊斯兰的头巾呢不能够朝向解域化的逃逸线，也就是解放性的逃逸线这个分叉。那么基于他对穆斯林国家和一些这个欧美的国家的妇女的采访呢，拉斯雷格呢，对当今那个有一个这个重新戴上面纱的这个趋势，他做了一个概述。他一方面主张国家及其这个机构呢，不应该要求这妇女戴面纱，但是也不应该禁止戴面纱。另外一方面，他敦促妇女呢不要戴面纱。他解释说，那个《可兰经》上没有这样的规定，至少按照他的解读，这个《可兰经》上没有要求妇女一定要戴面纱。那么面纱戴起来，他觉得他提供了一些理由，在这个书里说面纱戴起来很不方便，很这个 cumbersome。这个戴面纱呢是男人为了自己的利益而为女人所规定的。等等，这个怎么办？那么， 那么这个女社会先生注意到，这个戴面纱的这个面纱的复兴啊，实际上是这个伊斯兰教的一些领袖，他为了自己的目的，这个有组织的推广的，有组织的推行的，有组织的运动，所以拉斯雷格呢，拒绝那种认为戴面纱是妇女的一个自由选择的这样一个观点。因为这个拉斯雷格坚持认为呢，面纱与父权制的权力结构是密不可分的。
Lazarek points out that the veil is overlaid with meanings, but that its wearing is more than symbolic. It is also what she calls a complex and internally contradictory custom. In other words, the veil is both discourse and practice, social convention and personal act. It is not possible, in her view, to reclaim the veil as an expression of cultural pride,or in defiance of Western prejudices, because the veil is too caught up in conservative convention to be liberated for re-civilization. The veil is both an intimate bodily act and a tool of a repressive social apparatus. The personal act of assuming the veil contributes to the construction of an existential territory for the woman herself, but as a component of passage, kind of free-floating semiotic element, it can also communicate with other assemblages. But more crucially, the veil serves as a relay between the existential territory of the self and virtual universes of value. It is because the veil belongs to a larger universe of value, that it cannot be entirely personalized.
那个拉斯雷格指出呢，面纱实际上充满了意义，它本身充满了意义，但是戴面纱呢，不光具有象征性的意义，它也是一种复杂和内部充满矛盾的这种风俗。面纱同时是话语和实践，它既是这个社会传统的，也是一种个人行为，又是一种个人行为。在他看来呢，因为面纱卷入这个保守传统太深，所以不可能将其解放出来和重新象征化，不可能将面纱作为一种文化自豪的表达。或者反抗西方偏见的工具，戴面纱呢，既是一种亲密的身体行为呢，也是一种压抑性的社会装置的工具。那么戴面纱的个人行为，对戴这面纱的妇女自身来讲呢，有助于见到一种存在之欲。那么作为一种过渡过程的组成成分，过的组分。它也可以与其他的装配相沟通。那么更为关键的是呢，面纱在自我的存在之欲和虚拟的各种价值世界宇宙之间呢，起了一个这个中继站作用，就是这个在这个右边这个两个右上和右下这个两个这个象限起到一个中继站的作用。这是一种算子，这种算子是也有很具有变化性的。那么这是因为这个面纱属于一个更大的无法被彻底个人化的价值世界宇宙。
So the veil for a Muslim woman who wears the veil is just one example of an existential operator or a nucleus of subjectivation. So the veil or someone who wears it is an element around which the existential territory can be organized. But different people have different existential operators or different nuclei of subjectivation. So just to cite a last example of some of the existential operators that we might have at our disposal in an extremely deterritorialized space,This, of course, is a Ferrari on the Bund of Shanghai, with the shiny tall buildings in the background and some logos that one can spot walking around the Bund. So what can we do with this kind of territory that we have to live in today? What kind of elements can we bring into it? One can bring in something like the Islamic veil, what can we invent ourselves to be more creative? Sorry, that was spontaneous.
那个就是说这个对于这种个人的自身来讲呢，这个是有其实有各种不同这个存在主义的算子，也可以这个构建一些这个不同的这个就是这个他说这个主体化的核心吧，主体化的核心。那么不同的人就有不同的这个存在性的算子，可以这种不同的这个主体化的核心。比如说我们去上海在看那些高楼大厦的话，我们那个能够找到一种什么样的这个存在之域呢？能够找到什么样的存在性的这个算子的和这个主体化的这个核心呢？这个就是说是就是是一个问题吧，也是这个新世纪的一个追寻这种新的这个存在之域的这种要求吧。
Viewed with the help of the egosophic object, and that's that graph that Guattari uses of the territories, universes, phyla, and flows, culture can be defined as a reservoir of shared elements, such as the residual objects and semiotic substitutes that existentialize mental and social formations. These elements work through repetition, redundancy, and resonance.We see these different symbols and many others every day. They include, these elements include signs, symbols, verbal refrains, musical refrains, gestures, ritual, clothing, bodily markings, knowledge, belief, prejudices, and stereotypes. I skipped a bunch.
那么这个在生态这个智慧这个 ecosophy 的这个目标的这个帮助之下呢，文化可以被界定为一种这个共享元素的水库 reservoir 一种水库。那么这些共享元素呢，比如说像存在性的这个存在化的这个存在化精神，它的存在化是用了动词，存在化精神和社会形构之残留物和符号学的替代物，通过重复冗余和共振来起作用，它们包括这个符号、象征、叠句、叠歌、姿势、仪式、服装、身体标记、知识、信仰、偏见以及模式化的观念。那么这些元素呢，可被安排进不同的领域或者机构，例如组织化的宗教、国家、艺术组织、学校、媒体工业、节日等等。它们同样也可以附着于各种价值、美学的。伦理的、道德的、宗教的和金融的价值。
These residual elements may be arranged into various domains or institutions, such as organized religions, nations, arts organizations, schools, media industries, festivals, and so forth. They may likewise become attached to various types of value, aesthetic, ethical.Moral, religious, monetary, etc. Although that which is ascribed to the sphere of culture has by definition already undergone deterritorializing detachment, even as if, as in the case of animism, the detached semiotic elements are reattached to the earth, the redeeming feature of the cultural concept remains its deep connections to life and to the earth. Culture as a reservoir of semiotizing components couples a population to a territory, and the evolution of the world's meanings can be correlated to various historical processes of deterritorialization.
Okay. 这个尽管被归诸于文化领域的东西呢，从定义上来讲，他们已经经历过这个解域化的剥离。即便是像在万物有 animate 等万物有灵这种例子中，被剥离的符号学元素被重新附着于大地，但是文化概念的补偿性的性质呢，仍然保持着与生命和大地的深层的联系。那么作为符号化组成成分的这个水库的文化呢，将人权与界域联系起来。文化一词的词义呢，它的演化呢，可以用与各种解域化的历史进程关联起来。
Okay. Yeah. just have some.
Okay.
I want to go ahead and finish, but I wanted to leave time for questions and discussions and thoughts. It's very dense, and so I find that. That examples really help. Basically, my thought is I'm somebody who left my hometown in Texas to go to Paris to study, and then went and did my PhD in North Carolina, and now I live in Virginia, and I've been in China for a month, and this is my third visit, and I think my story is not so unusual. The United States looks nothing like it did when I was a child, and people tell me the changes are even more extreme here. So with this Guattari's ideas of how we can put culture, rearrange our elements of culture, put them back together in a ways that really benefit the individual and that work for the individual. And by individual, he doesn't just mean an individual person. It could be a group, a community, a family, people with different ideas. How can we not throw away our traditions because we need them, but not just go back to them, because that's not possible either. With modernization and globalization, even if you're critical of these things like I am, they still have brought us many wonderful things, like airplanes that bring us together. And I don't have an iPad, but I can't live without my computer or my smartphone. But how do we make meaningful lives with the elements that we have? And how do we avoid just going back to tradition for the sake of going back to tradition? And how do we make the planet better? Well, that sounds so idealistic, but I really admire that utopian element in Guattari.
我在德克萨斯长大，然后就去巴黎留学，巴黎学习，然后又在北卡读大学了，拿 PhD 这个学位，那么我的这个经历可能是还是比较普通的，但是就是说从小到大其实这个经历看的就是这个整个的社会整个世界在全球化的这个背景下，极度的这个经历了一个巨变，那么我来中国一看呢就是很多人跟我一样的感受。那么我今天就是提出这个瓜达利的这个文化思想来跟大家分享的是，因为我觉得瓜达利文化思想呢，它有一种就是这个对文化来讲是可以进行重组，重组它的思想里面有这个这种重组的这个文化和重构的文化，能够有益于这个个人，但个人不一定说是指具体的个体啊，就是 individual， 一般的是一些社区或者家庭，或者是不同，有不同价值或者不同这个理念的这些人群，那么瓜达利的这个文化思想的它那个就是说，不是说要完全抛弃传统，因为也不太可能，就是说，也不是说要简单的回归传统，因为也是不可能的，但是呢，它是这个传统里面也好，传统里好的东西，那现在的这个新的东西也好的东西，比如说像这个飞机能够把我们带在一起，比如说就像 iPad， 虽然我自己没有iPad，但是我离开电脑我就没法活，所以呢，怎么来在21世纪的这种极度简约化的这个境遇中，能够这个过着一种有意义的生活 ，meaningful life。 那么这个是简单的回顾传统，还是一个什么样的努力？那么瓜达利的思想能够给我们提供有益的启示。那么这看起来听起来好像有点理想主义啊，但是我觉得这个瓜达利的这个思想中的这个乌托邦的向度呢，我是比较欣赏的。
Okay, we have excellent interpreter.
Specialist of Guattari. I have no knowledge of Guattari. I just ask a simple question. Oh, yeah. She's a professor in Beijing Foreign Studies University on contemporary Chinese literature. So she, I want to know your concept of your integrated world capitalism of Guattari. How Guattari elaborate this concept? Because she noticed that in so-called socialist period, there is kind of slogan, socialist integration. So, for example, when we read history of Chinese literature compiled by Chinese Department of Peking University, they propose a kind of integrated concept of Chinese literature. So how want to know more about Guattari's concept of so-called IWC. Okay.
So, Guattari begins writing about integrated world capitalism in the middle of the 1980s, or maybe even early 1980s. I believe that the word globalization might have been around already, but he preferred integrated world capitalism, and I think it's because what's integrated is not just that more and more people are being brought into the capitalist system, but also that it integrates the subjective dimensions as well as the economy. For him, it's always more than economy. It's economy plus the mental and social formations that go with it. And so he was especially interested in or concerned about the effects of capitalism on people's lives and their ability to function and the functioning of society. And curiously, he actually included Soviet-style communism, Soviet-style bureaucracy in integrated world capitalism, because for him, it was part of the system. It wasn't separate. And I think that's arguable probably by the 1980s when things are starting to transform anyway. And especially by the early 1990s after the breakup of the Soviet Union, it became obvious that it was all part of the same system. I should also mention that in the late 1980s, Guattari co-authored a book with Antonio Negri, the Italian philosopher and political activist. And in French, it's called something like New Alliances for Liberty or something like that. But the English translation is Communists Like Us. And what he and Negri do is redefine communism to get it detached from the Soviet legacy that had a bad reputation by that time, even among the left, and to reclaim the importance of work to existence, so that work becomes neither capitalist nor communist. Work is something we do just to keep our lives going, because we all need something to do, or we go a little nuts. And also I think it's important to keep in mind that Guattari is writing both as a political activist and as a psychoanalyst. So he's somebody that's caring for people that are living in an institution, but is also interested in mental health care for everybody and healthy social formations for everybody. Concerned about institutions, he was concerned about education, new models of education that wouldn't just have the children sitting in the classroom like little soldiers, that would let them create and think for themselves, use play as part of learning. All this. He was a very 1970s, or European version of a 1970s kind of art. Set.
IWC 啊，什么一体化的实验组织资本资本世界资本主义 ，IWC 是他在瓜达涅在自己的书里的缩写。那么他提出这个一体化资本主义呢，是在1980年的早期。这个当然这个概念可能当时有类似的概念了，已经有了。那么他提这个概念不仅仅是说这个越来越多的人被卷入资本主义，这个是一方面，也是个事实。但是呢，他更强调的是说在这个进程中，在这个一体化资本主义的进程中，这个主体性的这个维度，就主体性也被资本主义化了，就这个意思吧。那么他不仅是强调这个世界资本主义的这个经济的方面，就是经济越来越资本主义化了，那么也强调这个 mental social 的方面，mental 就是这个精神性的这个社会性的精神的方面，就是社会性的方面。所以他的这个一体化资本主义呢，是这两方面相加，一个是这个经济性的，一个是精神和社会性的。那么他关心的是这个资本主义对这个人的这个影响，对人的影响，那么这个社会的这个对社会的这个作用吧。那么他的比较有意思的是，就是瓜塔利的这个一体化的世界资本主义呢，它也同时包括了这个苏联的这个模式，苏联的这个官僚这个所谓共产主义的这个官僚社会主义的模式也包括进去了，他认为也是处于这个一体化的这个社会主义的一体化的资本主义的这个一环。那么在当时的话，这个意见可能是这个比较独特的，但是后来就是在1989年左右这个苏联解体之后，那么大家都很清楚了，都恍然大悟了，原来瓜塔利说的是对的。那么在1980年代晚期呢，这个瓜塔利跟那个奈格里，就是跟那个麦克哈特合写这个帝国的意大利的哲学家，也是一个政治活动分子、政治积极分子，他们写了一本书，就是法语叫什么什么新的联盟啊，那么英文翻译成就是像我们这样的共产主义者，有一个这样的书，那么是瓜塔利跟那个奈格里合作的，他们重新界定了这个一些东西，比如说这个 IWC， 那么他们认为这个东西，这个世界一体化的世界资本主义呢，不能够把苏联苏式的这个社会主义那个从里面分离，而是也在这个里面。那么这个瓜塔利自身呢，他自己也是一个政治活动家，他同时也是一个医师。那么所以他关注的所以他的关注点呢就很重视这个在资本主义体制下的这个人的这个精神方面的这个健康，人的精神方面的健康。他是这个比如说他从事基督教教育这样的
I have one question. I'm more interested in Occupy Wall Street. I think at the beginning, we can get a lot of news about Occupy Wall Street in China, but later, I think all the news disappeared very quickly. So could you talk more about Occupy Wall Street? What's going on now? Yes, we know Guthrie had no chance to see what's going on over there, butcould you criticize this movement? Do you think it is, are there some meaningful things to the movement of the world? Yeah, thank you.
Actually, Occupy Wall Street is one of the examples I had in mind when I wrote this paper, and I apologize for not knowing as many of the details of the Occupy movement as I might know. I just know what I read in the press. But it has not been in the news in the United States either for quite some time. I think Occupy Wall Street is a good example of one of these collective subjective mutation where suddenly quite a number of people were willing to actually go out in the streets and demonstrate. So Occupy happened not just in New York, Wall Street, the original, but there were Occupies all over the country. Even on some university campuses, there was one on Duke campus. My campus in Virginia Tech, which is fairly conservative, did not have overnight campers, but they did have weekly demonstrations that would attract a few people. Yes, there was a lot of hope around it. And just the fact of so many people being willing to spend the night outside was quite extraordinary. Social media, of course, was very important in organizing it and keeping it going. Getting it into the news was important. A number of high-profile people spoke at it. So it became a different kind of demonstration because it also had this sort of sense of fun at the same time. But as usual, there are ways to contain this kind of movements. The cities would come up with ordinances, with rules. Oh, you can't sleep outside here, or you can't gather here, or they would make it impossible from the point of view of infrastructure, have a place where people go to the bathroom, or they would say, oh, it's unhealthy, or if anything violent happened around there, they would blame it on Occupy. So there were a number of, I think if you're a fan of Foucault, you could call it governmentality type tactics to shut it down. I hope that somebody out there is still doing something, but it isn't what it was because of all these different tactics to control public space in the United States. Our public space is not as public as one would think. You do have to have a permit to demonstrate. You have to file with the police. There are a lot of rules for demonstrating, and if you don't follow the city's specific rules, they will shut you down. And they learned how to do it in a way that looks nonviolent. They learned this from the 1960s, from the anti-Vietnam protests. We have our ways of being totalitarian in the United States.
北京工程大学那个教授沈彦林提了一个问题，就是怎么看那个占领华尔街的这个运动，然后这个怎么评价，就是说这个比如像在中国这个占领华尔街运动曾经那个有过报道，但是到现在这个销声匿迹已经很久了，那我想知道在占领华尔街运动这个之间也发生了什么样的事情啊。那么简单华生教授说这个占领华尔街运动那个不光是在中国在消失了，在美国也消失了，在报章杂志上都没有了啊。那么他觉得这个是他本来要谈的，这个是他的所谓的集体化的主体性的善变的一个很好的例子 ，collective 的 subjective 的 mutation。他觉得这个占领华尔街运动是很有意义的一个事情，很多人那个出去游行示威，这个运动不光是发生在纽约，也席卷了这个全美国的全美国各大城市，还有这个全美国的很多的校园，比如像杜克大学，有这样的占领类似的占领运动，还有这个他所在的弗吉尼亚理工大学，他也有类似的活动，但是他弗吉尼亚那个以前是个蓄奴州吧，非常保守，到现在也还保守，所以这个弗吉尼亚理工大学它这个是一个比较保守的地方，所以没有这个说每天晚上在那占领，但是周末有这样的活动，周末有这样的活动，他认为这个里面是有很多希望，大家有很多希望寄托在上面，那么很多人就是他这个 不计安危，不计这个其他东西，它在外面过夜，当帐篷来进行占领活动。那么社会媒体就是他认为这个是extraordinary 的，是非法的一些举动。那么这个社会媒体在这样的占领华尔街运动里面也发挥了很大的作用，在组织这个在愿意做这个占领运动的时候起了很重要的作用。他这个社会媒体不是指大众媒体啊，他把这两个概念区分了。大众媒体是这个主要是资本控制的或者国家控制的，社会媒体它是微观的媒体，比如说像他刚才说的是演讲里面说的是可移动的存在之欲，口袋里就可以掏出一个手机出来，然后可以就是发发消息的感觉啊，就是这种新媒体、社会媒体。所以很多人站出来说话，他觉得是很有意义的、很有希望的一件事情。那这里面他觉得也很有意思，就是大家在一起看嘛，这个很热闹，这个很fun，就是有很多有意思的东西在里面。但是很不幸的是，这个有就是说这个统治阶级的有很多办法来控制、来消灭这些运动。所以呢，它就是很多发生占领运动的城市呢，它会做出很多限制出来，来 contain 来那个操控这个控制来那个压制这些运动。比如说你占领者，你不能在外面睡觉，你不能睡在公园里面，你不能这个你不能这个想讲的些好的不能，我已经忘了啊。那个他说你不能这样，不能那样的，就是哦，你不能在这个地方指定的地方，尤其是为这个地方是公共领域公园里，你不能。扎营。所以很多的这个而且媒体他会宣传这个很暴力，就是这个战争呢很暴力的，他们很脏的，这些人都是没有素质的，所以就是就给他们进行妖魔化和这个进行限制。那么统治阶级用这些符合意义上的这个所谓治理 governmentality， 符合整个概念叫治理术，通过这些治理术来达到这个控制社会的目标，就是要关闭这些运动，要杀断，把这些运动取缔。我是希望这个有这样的这个社会性的善变，但是在美国这个有很强的这个统治阶级很有力量控制社会，来控制社会，控制社会所谓这个公共空间 public space， 它可以允许你游行，但是它有很多规则，那你的规则让你没法施展手脚吧，能够把你这个。把它那个关闭掉，而且，前面。
Yes, thank you, Professor, for your wonderful speech. My question is about Guattari's, three ecologies. My concern is about environmental ecology. We know when the environmental protection movement boom, several decades ago, Christianity was harshly criticized because in the Bible, the God gave human beings overwhelming control over nature. So Christianity was harshly criticized because of its late response and reluctant engagement in environmental protection and ecology movement. But Christianity later explained that human beings was a less competent steward. So we human beings will try to be a good one later. So what's your comment on this explanation? Is there any idea or concept in Guattari's books or ideas concerning this topic? Thank you.
That's an interesting question, especially the tying in the Christianity and the Christian values that put man in charge of nature. One Guattari type response would be that we have two universes of value here, the universe of value of the environmentalist and then the Christian universe of value coming together. Guattari criticized actually the environmentalists of his day, the 70s, because he did not think that they paid enough attention to politics or to other social issues. So he thought that they would be more effective, both in their environmental concerns, but also that they should pay more attention to mental and social factors. So that's why he calls it the three ecologies. But today, and I think this question of Christianity show us how important it is to address those value factors and existential territory factors, the mental factors and the social factors, in order for the environmentalist cause to be furthered. And now people actually have more awareness of the environment. And I think it's because maybe those two universes of values were able to coalesce into a new assemblage that was able to rethink the human-animal relationship and realize that we're destroying the animals, and in the end, it'll destroy us. Does that make sense as an assemblage type? I've actually not heard this environmental critique of Christianity, but in another paper I recently did, I used this the Adam and Eve story as an illustration. It's in Derrida's essay on the animal. Derrida goes through the Adam and Eve story and Bible stories to criticize this attitude toward animals, which he associates with all of Western philosophy, starting with the Greeks in the idea of Prometheus, the idea that man is in charge of the planet. So for Derrida, it's not just the Christians, it's all of Western philosophy and all of Western thought.
他说这个如果是他的问题就是你把这个中文问题跟他说一下好吗？就是我翻译的是这个巴达里的这个关于环境生态方面的问题。我们知道那个当环保运动和生态运动刚开始的时候，前几十年前开始的时候呢，基督教呢因为那个在旧约里面的话就是上帝给人给赋予人对自然的这个生态大权。这方面受到批评，而且基督教在这方面的反应迟钝，然后对环保的这个参与不利而受到更多批评。基督教后来他们后来出来说呢，我们人作为这个地球的这种 steward， 就是大概是管理者或者管家呢，做得太好，我们以后要做得更好一些。那后面可能参与的就后面多了一些。那么我想问教授，他对这个有过评价？然后巴达里的思想中对这方面有没有什么这个关注或者？
So, Christianity is still don't pay attention to environmental issues right now, compared to contemporary knowledge.
Probably not.
Okay. 好，那我知道。就是说，如果那个按瓜达里的这个方式来理解的话，他就是说，这个是两种不同的这个价值宇宙、价值世界。他所讲的这个 reference， 这个 universals of the references。一种就是这个环保主义者的，一种是这个基督徒的，基督教的。他认为就是说这个瓜达里自己呢，在1970年呢，对这个当时兴起的环保运动呢，有一些批判。他认为这个当时的环保运动呢，他那个好像就环保而环保，好像那个就是论事吧，没有注意这种政治和社会的这个议题。那么他认为这个瓜达里认为更有效的方法是要那个要注意，也同时注意到这个精神的。和社会的这个因素，所以他提出三种生态学，不光是环境生态学，还有社会生态学，还有精神生态学。那么他自己作为精神分析医师，他也非常关注人的精神的这个健康的问题，也是一种生态。他认为，那么这是就是说，这些东西呢，就是跟这个存在之欲啊，跟这些这个 mental 的这个精神的和社会的这个维度都联系起来，应该。所以呢，他就是说这个，到现在的就是说，有可能是说这两种装配它，有一些的关联，这两种思考环境问题的方法，可能能够关联起来，能够在形成对撞这样的，就是说融合，能够形成一种新的装配。因为按照这个瓦森教授的理解的话，瓜达里的思想关于这个新的装备怎么形成的话，它也可以利用那个旧的东西、旧的装配的一些残留物，或者说符号学的替代物， 哪怕是这种东西是这个这种是甚至是反动的或者是宗教的，它都可以利用的。就是说新的这个环保这个价值宇宙可以结合这些东西来形成新的这个装配。那么他举了一些他也举了这个德利达的例子哈，德利达这个关注这个也关注人和动物的这个关系这个议题。那么这个德利达这个认为这个就是这种对自然的这种好像人是自然的这个主宰这样的这个想法呢，其实不仅仅是这个西方基督教的这个问题，而是西方整个哲学的问题。
Time for one more question.
Repeat.
One more question, please.
我问一个问题，就是刚才您讲这个装置的时候，是讲的那种装置。其实，在加法里的那个最后一本书中，Cosmos 有三种装置，对吧？三种装置。那么您用一种，其实在这三种装置里边，有一个很重要的问题，您谈到是有一个，就是。加上你提出了一种新的审美范式，这种美学在它的整个这个装置当中如何来发挥它的作用？我想请您解释一下这个。
那新的美学范式最后一句话是什么？
新的美学范式
最后一句话。
新的美学范式在这个它的整个三种装置当中，它是如何来生成它的这种主体性的这种特有化？
其实我先跟他回答一下，他其实不是说只讲一种装置，他这个很他这经常用的是辅助，但是他你可以再让他说一下哈，我跟他说一下。要 talking about 这个 assemblage， mainly it seems to me is mainly one kind of assemblage， but as far as I know， Guattari's late work Cosmosis。He mentioned three kinds of assemblages. So, and he also proposed a new kind of aesthetic paradigm. How do you comment, his new aesthetic paradigm within his, his idea, conceptualization of three assemblages?
What he means by aesthetic paradigm is that unlike Jacques Lacan, who used a sort of algebra to describe the unconscious, Guattari just borrows from the different models, like the meta-modeling. So revolution might be one model, the Oedipus is one model that's out there, the chaos theory. So rather than taking chaos theory literally, and trying to use mathematics to, for example, analyze the behavior of a crowd, he takes it more as just ideas to play around with, like an artist, that's the example he gives, like an artist using a palette to create the artworks. So that's the aesthetic paradigm, and that's why that graph of the four domains. He insists that it's very fluid and it's not to be used like a mathematical graph. He makes a distinction at one point between mathematical consistency and machinic consistency. So if it works, it's consistent with a machine. But in mathematics, and some of you might know lots more mathematics than me, in mathematics, if there's a contradiction, then there's a problem with the paradigm. In aesthetic paradigms, in a machine, sometimes it can be not quite right according to the plan, but it kind of works anyway. So he's trying to acknowledge the complexities of real life, and for him, he does not believe that the complexities of real life are entirely can be mathematized. So that's why he calls it aesthetic paradigm. And so the three ecologies, I think with the idea of ecology, it's a looser kind of organization. And I think that's why he's interested in a political movement like the Occupy movement, because it isn't rigidly organized with this party boss reporting to that one and these rigid lines of command. Something like the Occupy movement, it started in New York, and other places saw it and wanted to do the same thing. So it was more like repeating a pattern of behaviors, repeating a loose group of strategies that they adapted to each place, rather than somebody saying, okay, you over there, you do this, you over there, you do that. Because he was always concerned with how to organize things so that they're organized enough to cohere, but not so organized that they become constraining and don't work anymore. Because for him, things work better, and that's the idea of chaos osmosis. Things work best when they're just on the edge of organized and yet open to mutation.
那个德斯专家，那个其他这个我们重来发吧。你来翻译。是吗？是吗？这个很难呀。这个。Yeah, I feel very, very complicated. So, okay. So,
we would, let's take the, idea of mathematics. So if you do a mathematical problem and try to analyze a crowd using mathematics, you can get a fairly accurate model of how the crowd works. But there are always going to be little elements that the mathematical model misses, and also our mathematics, even the good mathematics, don't predict very well. And it has to do with the predictability and just an inability to predict. So instead of even trying to use maths, he uses what he calls the aesthetic paradigm, where you just take bits and pieces of what's there and put it back together the way an artist. So it's the contrast between the way an artist might create something and the way an engineer might create something.
这个就是说，他那个主要是刚才回答是说是，这个美学范式在瓜达利他是怎么个意思吧？那么他那个就是说这个虽然是他们提到哈，虽然这个瓜达利他是非常感兴趣科学，因为那个数学，但他认为这个数学的模式，数学的范式啊，那个他的诉求是说要那个要要是这个东西要成为一个这种非常准确的东西。 非常准确的模式，但是呢，数学的模式其实呢，它也需要很多东西，因为很多东西它处理不了的，它这个可预测性呢也不见得很准，所以呢，就是说它提出一种这个美学，审美的这个范式，这个审美的范式它更重要的重视这种就是说，这个不确定性、不稳定性，那么就是说这个，他认为这个还有流动性，比如说。 这种东西是数学模式，它不能够这个处理的。那么它这个有点像那个艺术家的这个处理方式，就是艺术家他用一种调色板来这个调颜色，那么你不可能用数学的这个精确的预测的东西来衡量这个艺术家的这个艺术创作。所以呢，就是说这个用这个审美方式来看这个占领华尔街运动的话，就比较清楚了。就是说这个占领华尔街运动的话，虽然可能有一些组织者或者是这个。 这个发动者，但是他没有领导，没有这个老板，没有说这个一个领袖说指挥，这部分人干什么，那部分人干什么，你应该没有一些这个所谓这个 rigid line， 就是没有一个严格的界限，严格的这个规则，让你去做什么做什么，所以呢，是它里面有很多重复冗余，还有一些这个别的不确定性的东西，所以呢，他觉得这个这是那个瓜达利所讲的这个。 审美范式的意思，美学范式的意思。
Especially for the very informative lecture, so I have one question. So in through your interpretation, it seems to me that somehow God already implied before the formation of the individual, there do exist a place which is somehow matter. That means it's somehow pre-individual, pre-consciousness. So, if it is true, so if we cannot direct or we end, predict the formation of individuality. So how could we engage ourselves consciously or reasonably into the formation of such a society?
你那个，不是，你那个，就我这老师的阐释，我觉得加法蒂大概在他的理论当中设置这么一个地方，这么一个地方就是前个体的，他负责的就是我们个体是怎么形成的，或者构成的，是潜意识的，他负责你的意识的形成。那如果说这样一个场域呢，我们没有办法去指导他，去引导他，去有意识的去了解他，那么我们如何去？ 让我们参与到这样的一种主体的建构当中，同时又是有意识的，又是理性的。我意思就是说，这个美学模式它说的什么 uncertainty 啊， accuracy 啊，但是这种东西我们无力度去参与进去，是否是一种理性的选择呢？就在哪里？
That's an interesting question, and his ideas on child development are rather than trying to think it in the rigid terms of the mother, father, child, subject positions, the way a structuralist psychoanalysis would, he thinks of it in terms of affective universes. And it's not just the mother and the father, it's the brothers and the sisters, the school, the children's friends, what the child experiences watching television or playing with the dog. And so the sense of self is going to form within these different universes of reference in the child's own experiences of the world. And so it's important that the child have access to rich experiences and be able to create with these different elements available to it rather than the strict lots of rules. So like I said, it's a very 1970s kind of an approach to child rearing, but I think his main point is that it's not just the mother and the father, it's the whole environment around the child from which it's going to absorb and form itself. And it is unpredictable, but the main thing is to have the rich interactive experience there. And expose the child to lots of different inputs.
那么这个意识形成是关于意识形成的问题，比如说这个儿童怎么发展自己的自我意识，他那个就是说这个没有这个严格的这个好像是一些就是给一些有严格的分野一些严格的规定。 那么结构主义的话，或者说精神分以前的精神分析的话，他会做一些这个严格的区划，就是而且他们更加重视所谓的这个父子母子父女母女这样的这个家庭关系。那么巴塔利呢，他是这个觉得这个以前的精神分析这种结构主义的东西，他觉得不太可靠，而是应该就是说把这个东西更延展到更广泛的方面。 比如说这个他的一些，比如说不同的这个 effective universities of reference， 这个感受性的这个价值宇宙，各种感受性的价值世界价值宇宙，要把这些东西都考量进来，而不是简单的就是家庭的，也是这个家庭结构的一些关系，它也可以，它这个不同的感受性的价值宇宙，它包括一些比如说朋友的关系啊，或者说是儿童在跟。 跟这个动物的关系啊，在玩狗的时候，它建立的一些关系啊，就是说，不光是这个人与人，也可以是人与物，或者是物与物，这里面都是一个形成这个就是意识的一些场域吧，这些价值宇宙互相作用一下，共同形成这个人的这些意识，所以呢，他觉得以前的这个东西，它是有局限的。 那么新的这个考量方法应该把不同的因素、把不同的价值宇宙、不同的参照宇宙、参照世界都考量进来。那么这个实际上也是一种1960年代，在欧洲发展起来的一种新的，跟以前的精神分析不太一样的一种分析方法。就是更加考虑一些这个复杂的经验，一些各种不同的价值宇宙的这个交汇和冲撞。
I know you have many, many questions to ask, but time is too limited. we don't have the assemblage to control it. Sorry for that. But thank you very much for your excellent speech, and also thank you for your wonderful translation, and thank you for all for coming.